Hi, I'm Jeff Gonzales, president of Trident Concepts. I'm here with FTA to talk to you as instructors about what to do when you have that guy in class. It's inevitable that at some point in your instructing career that you're going to run into somebody that becomes a detriment. And you may have to consider some options in dealing with that. So let's take a step back and let's talk about what we're really referencing. And we're talking about a student who is either not teachable or they're unsafe. So either one of those scenarios is bad, but they have different outcomes. The first one we talk about is a student that's unsafe. If depending on the content, you may find somebody that is unsafe due to ignorance. They just don't know. They don't know the firearm safety rules. They don't know how to behave or when to do things. They have a hard time following the simplest of instructions. So that's kind of a common thing that you might see with a new student. And then there's somebody that should know better that yet still performs a safety violation. And accidents do happen, but that's also one of the reasons that safety rules are in place to try to prevent them from happening. So if you have somebody that has repeatedly performed unsafely, then you need to start to consider about what to do with them. And we've talked in the past where I use a three strike process. The first time it's an unsafe act, they will have a stern warning. The second time, I'll have them step out of the evolution. The third time is I will dismiss them from class. So dealing with safety, that we've kind of talked about that a lot, but let's talk about somebody that's uncoachable. When they come to that point, when a student is uncoachable, and they can be uncoachable for a lot of different reasons. Number one, they're not in the right class. They're overwhelmed by the material and they just can't take it all in. All right, that's one reason. The other reason is there's sometimes a desire for students to try and, I don't want to use the term show off, but impress the instructor with their knowledge. And what they're trying to do, basically what they're trying to do is they're attention getters. They want everybody to know that they have this knowledge and they know what they're doing. And that's great. But when it happens all the time in a class, it becomes a nuisance and it becomes a time issue where you have to address the issues with that one student. So you have to be really careful about how you manage your time. If one student is monopolizing your time, you've got to address that. It's one thing for a student to have a legitimate question because they do not understand what they're doing, in which case it is your obligation to inform them or provide them the instructions in a manner that they can understand, which means that you might need to rebrief the drill in a different way so they can understand it. Then there, I have a student that will have questions like that, and I have to take a step back and answer those questions because it's important that they have that information so they can act safely. It's another thing when they're asking questions for the sake of asking questions, and when they develop a pattern of this, if it's relevant to the subject at hand, you have to make a decision as to whether or not you want to continue to answer those questions. It also might come to the point where maybe you defer to answering that questions after class. So I want to take these questions from students because a lot of times it's the only time they're going to have to actually converse with me, because once I leave that class, I'm on my way to the next class and I've got a whole other batch of students that I have to manage there. So that one student that has those questions, you may need to just try to compartmentalize them so that it doesn't affect the rest of the class, so you don't lose out. Because what the dynamics of a class are tricky. What ends up happening if one student monopolizes the time of the instructor, the other students pay attention to that, and then what ends up happening by kind of like by accident is that they won't ask questions. They won't ask questions because number one, they feel like that they'd rather be shooting, and this guy's asking all the questions, which means that I don't want to take time to ask my question because I want to go and shoot. That's what I came here for. That's bad. The second is that the students realize that this student is monopolizing the instructor's time, and they're disappointed by that because they might have good questions, but they also want to get back to shooting. So you have to kind of manage that, and the best way to manage it, again, is to just tell the student that you would like to answer those questions, but you need to do it in a time that's not going to interrupt everybody else's training value that they're there for. So it's not just one student that paid for a class, it's, you know, the 10 to 12 to 16 students that are there. And if you are constantly having to address that one student's issues, it affects everybody else's experience, which, again, I talked about this in previous videos, which is the student doesn't necessarily have to have a positive outcome. We certainly want it to be a positive experience. If one of the students is creating a negative environment that could lead to a negative experience, that's going to reflect on you. You have to manage that by talking to the student and making sure they understand that there's a time and a place to ask all those questions. But here's the thing. If it has anything to do with safety, you have to address it. So if that question that they keeps getting, if the same student keeps asking the same questions, but they're related to safety, you've got to address it. Even though it may be annoying or it may be redundant, you cannot pass up diving or going deeper into a subject such as safety. That's the thing. Other things that may make it difficult to work with a student, an uncoachable student, is when they have more of a know-it-all attitude. Here's the thing. The student paid a tuition to come and listen to what you do, how you do your training. You might need to remind them of that. Hey, listen, I get that there's other ways to do this, but you paid tuition to hear how I do it. So why don't we take a moment here to just trust that what I'm doing is valuable? You came here for that reason. And why don't you wait until after to pass judgment on what it is that you're being exposed to? If somebody just has a very closed off mind and doesn't want to take into consideration all the other possibilities of how instruction is delivered, it's going to make for a very small or narrow training opportunity. And they're hobbling themselves as far as what they can gain, what they can learn, what they can discover. So for those types of situations, the best way to manage that, again, is, you know, just you have to be upfront and honest. You have to really kind of talk to the class and let them know, you know, that's not ideal to try to do that. They're there to learn from you in that moment. Another problem is a student can become uncoachable when their performance is suffering. If they had certain expectations about their performance and all of a sudden they're not able to demonstrate that performance, it can have a negative effect on that student. They can start to shut down and be less open to the information that you're trying to provide them. And that's a tricky thing. And once they go down that uncoachable road, it can make it really hard. It can make it difficult. And as an instructor, you almost have to do triage, meaning that you have to kind of evaluate students' potential. And, you know, if this student has got great potential, you need to be spending time with that student. If this student doesn't have that potential, then you need to make sure that you can manage the range in a safe manner, that they can participate, but yet spend your time with the students that have the greatest potential. So that's kind of triage in a sense. So if they get to that point where they're very frustrated, you have to be able to address that. It doesn't matter the skill level or what we're talking about here. Nobody was born with that skill. They had to work for it. They had to train and practice and put in the long hours and discipline. So you have to remind them that even somebody like myself or any of the other founding members, we didn't get to where we were. We had to work for it. And so in the early stages of your career, your training career, you're probably going to find yourself being frustrated, disappointed. And those are normal for anything that you're learning, no matter what it is. So you have to be able to express that to them and say, hey, listen, I get that you're frustrated. And I sense that you're shutting down. And that's the wrong thing to do right now. You need to realize that when I was in your shoes, I was terrible. And I struggled and I was frustrated and I had all the same problems that you have. When you can relate to that student, they may be able to open back up and kind of just let that pass. Because a lot of times, that's their ego speaking. And if you can just manage that or address that in a professional manner, it will probably be something that they're like, huh, all right, yeah, I realize that, you know, it probably took you a long time to get to where you are, so I should probably expect the same thing. Because unfortunately, we live in a, you know, instant gratification type world these days, and people are expecting that after 2 days, they should be, you know, diving through the air, doing, you know, SWAT rolls and hitting targets at 100 yards with, you know, one hand. Not really how it works. Not really at all how it works. So they have to also manage their expectations, which is also one of your jobs. You've got to be able to manage the expectations of the class. And a lot of that has to do with diving into the why of the curriculum. Why are they here? Why are they here for this class? Helping them to manage those expectations. So it is inevitable that you're probably going to have students that are unsafe and uncoachable. We talked about how to deal with unsafe students, and you have to have a zero tolerance for that. You cannot allow for an unsafe student to be on your range for an extended period of time. As soon as you've identified that, you've got to take action. And you have to be also sympathetic, because a lot of times it's either it's ignorance or it can be deliberately indifferent. So if it's ignorance, it's one thing. If it's deliberately indifferent, it's a whole other ballgame. And then when we move to the uncoachables, you really have to work hard to try to separate all those variables there and try to figure out, is there something that I can do? You know, can I relate to this person? Can I help them understand that? And if so, you may find that they come out from that uncoachable shell. The bottom line is that you're there to impart your knowledge. You're there to try to help them get to where they need to be. So if you can remind them of that and remind them that the road is going to be probably more difficult than they thought, chances are they'll recognize that and be a little bit better off in that sense. So I'm Jeff Gonzales with Trident Concepts. Thanks for tuning in. Again, protect the profession.